So we've talked informally about limits as this idea of describing the behavior of a graph, looking at what's happening around some specific x value. Now we want to start to formalize that a little bit, introduce some notation and some definition. So first, let's actually define what we mean by a limit. So the first thing we'll need is some notation that we'll be using. So this notation LIM, shorthand for limit. So we want to evaluate the limit of our function f of x, whatever that given function is, as x approaches some value c. So we can say that that limit equals some value L if our function value f of x gets closer and closer to some value L as x gets closer and closer to c. So our function doesn't ever have to actually equal that value of L. We just need it to get closer and closer to that value. So when we consider limits, we can also consider one-sided limits, which we informally talked about in the graph in the last video. We looked at what's happening as we approach from the left, as we approach from the right. So we can consider the limit of our function f of x as x approaches c with a little plus sign to mean x approaching c from the right. One way to think of it is that plus kind of indicating a positive infinity. So you would start at x equals positive infinity, which is always way off to the right, and then approach that point. Or we can consider left-hand limits. So we can take the limit as x approaches c from the left. So we indicate that with that minus sign of f of x. So we're saying x is approaching c from the left. So we use that negative sign, so you can think of that as starting at negative infinity, which would always be far off to the left, and then tracing along your graph following up until you get to that point. So we can consider the limit of the function at c as we approach from the left, as we approach from the right, each of those pieces individually. And we have a theorem that's going to be handy, especially when we're looking at graphs to come up with limits. So we can say that the limit as x approaches c of our function f of x is equal to some value L if and only if. So this double arrow just means that this theorem is true both in both directions. If we can demonstrate that the limit as x approaches c from the right-hand side is exactly the same as the limit as x approaches c from the left-hand side of our given function are both equal to the same value. So if we can find this limit, and they're both equal to the same thing, then our function has a limit as x approaches c, and it's going to be that exact same number. So let's take the exact same graph that we looked at before, and now instead of talking informally, we want to use this limit notation to describe the behavior of our function, or to talk about what's happening around each of these x values. So in our first case, we want to consider x equals negative 1. So as x approaches negative 1 from the right, so again, think about starting with positive infinity. So we're headed from positive infinity down to this point. We're approaching a function value of 4. So we can say the limit as x approaches c, x approaches negative 1 from the right-hand side of our function is going to be 4. We can say that the limit as x approaches negative 1 from the left-hand side of our function, so again, that means starting from negative infinity and working our way up, So as we approach from the left-hand side, we're approaching that same function value of 4. Since those two values are equal to each other, that means that the limit as x approaches negative 1 of our function is also 4. So we look at the right-hand limit, left-hand limit. If those are both exactly the same thing, then our limit at that point is that exact same value. So now at x equals negative 4, we'll look at the same process. We'll consider the limit as x approaches negative 4 from the right. So as we approach negative 4 from the right-hand side, again, we're approaching this function value of negative 2. Even though our function value never actually hits that point, that's the value that we're getting closer to. So that would be a limit of negative 2. If we consider the limit as x approaches negative 4 from the left-hand side, we're approaching a function value of 3. So our limit's going to be 3. Since those two values are not equal to each other, we would say that the limit as x approaches negative 4 of f of x does not exist, or DNE. Since the left-hand limit and right-hand limit are different, those limits are different, the limit itself does not exist. And again, it's just making use of this theorem that we introduced. For the limit to exist, those two one-sided limits have to be equal. So when we consider at x equals 2, we can consider as we approach from the right-hand side, so that right-hand limit, so as we approach 2 from the right, we're approaching a function value of 5. As we approach from the left, we're approaching a function value of negative 1. Again, those two values are not equal. So we would say that the limit as x approaches 2 of f of x does not exist, or shorthand notation DNE. In our last example, we'll be looking at what's happening around x equals 4. So we'll consider the limit as x approaches 4 from the right-hand side. In this case, we're approaching a function value of 2. As we approach 4 from the left-hand side, we're also approaching that same function value of 2. So in this case, since our right and left-hand limits are the same, we would say that the limit as x approaches 4 of our function f of x is 2. So again, check the left and right-hand limits. If they're the same, that's the limit for our function. And notice that in this case, the limit exists even though the function itself is undefined. So even though at x equals 4, our function is undefined, we still have a limit. Because limits aren't concerned with what's happening at that point itself, just what's happening as we get closer and closer from each direction.